This afternoon, my presentation is going to use the figure of Annie Oakley to talk about Buffalo Bill's Wild West in Barcelona. It's really more about the Wild West in Barcelona than about Annie Oakley herself, because it's the Wild West in Barcelona that is the focus of the research for my book. Earlier this summer, I know some of you were here for a presentation that I gave about John M. Burke, and a departure from the norm was that I gave that presentation a subtitle, and I decided that I would give today's presentation a subtitle. And the subtitle of today's presentation is, "What's a nice girl like you doing in a place like this?" Now, I didn't have much success with lines like that when I was younger, so let's hope that I can make up for past failings in what I'll say to you in the course of the next 45 minutes or so. So, to the question, what's a nice girl like you doing in a place like this? I dare say for some of you, you won't have had the opportunity to go to Barcelona. So maybe we should say, a place like what?
And cry, come on,
Now I'd like to tell you a story. When I was young, I was told that all stories should begin once upon a time. So once upon a time, in a land far, far away, there was a tooth. It wasn't an ordinary tooth. It wasn't a magic tooth like the teeth that you might hear about in a fairy story, a dragon's tooth or a wizard's tooth. But it was a very special tooth. 25 years ago, when I was a student in Barcelona, I used to teach English twice a week in St. Paul's Hospital. And St. Paul's Hospital is the building that you can see behind me. And the teaching suite in St. Paul's Hospital was in the basement. And to get to the teaching suite, you had to go through the anatomical museum. And on display in the anatomical museum in St. Paul's Hospital in Barcelona was a tooth. And it said on the little ticket beside the glass case that the tooth was displayed in, that this was the tooth that William F. Cody, Buffalo Bill, had removed while he was in Barcelona. Now, I was an impressionable young man at that stage in my life, and I remember thinking to myself, I didn't know Buffalo Bill's Wild West was in Barcelona. And I remember thinking to myself, well, it must have made quite an impression if all of these years later they have the tooth that William F. Buffalo Bill Cody had extracted while he was in Barcelona, prominently displayed in a glass case in the anatomical museum in St. Paul's Hospital. And they all lived happily ever after. No, they didn't. In 2005, they redeveloped St. Paul's Hospital, and the shocking story appeared in the newspaper El Mundo that the tooth of Buffalo Bill had gone missing from the anatomical museum. All I can say is, it wasn't me. Anyway, let's move away from the story that gives you something of an idea as to why I started working on Buffalo Bill in Barcelona and start looking a little more at when, where, and why was Buffalo Bill in Barcelona. Before we start talking about Annie Oakley, of course, because I do want to focus on Annie Oakley in this afternoon's presentation. Buffalo Bill's Wild West went to Barcelona in December 1889 and was there for 5 weeks. They went to Barcelona because they had been appearing in Paris at the Universal Exhibition in the summer of that year. And while they were appearing in Paris, people came by train from a number of other European countries to see the Wild West, and they thought there would be a market for their great exhibition of frontier life, as it was called in the pre-publicity for Barcelona, in various other parts of Europe. An enterprising Catalan theatre manager called Verger offered them the opportunity of coming to Barcelona for 5 weeks on very good terms, and that was what they did. So Barcelona was the first stop that they made on this European tour outside of France. They were in Paris for the Universal Exhibition. They went south to Lyon in November of that year. They then went on to Marseille, and then they travelled to Barcelona. There's very little information published about the time that the Wild West spent in Barcelona. There are only 3 known photographs from the time that the Wild West spent in Barcelona. That's one of them. That's the La Jota y Tancha Chicola, or Little Chief, going into his teepee at the campsite in Barcelona. That's a group of La Jota men preparing to enter the arena from behind the scenes in Barcelona. And those are some of the buffalo behind the scenes in Barcelona. These pictures belong to the Centre Excursionista de Catalunya in Barcelona, and I am grateful for their permission to use them this afternoon as part of this presentation. We know that there are a number of other images from Barcelona in private collections. I have seen one of these photographs from Barcelona that's in a private collection myself. Jordi Maril Escudé, who wrote a short study in Catalan about the Wild West in Barcelona, has one of these private collection photographs on the cover, the rear cover of his book. I have contacted the people that gave him permission to use that, and I mean, his book was published about 13, 14 years ago, and I didn't get a reply, so it may be that the address or something has changed, so I don't have permission to show that image, but we do have Jordi Maril Escudé's book in the library here, if anyone would like to see that other image that we can be certain is from Barcelona. But as I said, we'd be pretty sure that there are some other images in private collections, because the Wild West camp in Barcelona featured a tent with a photographer where it was possible for members of the public to go, pay a small fee and have their photograph taken with one of the performers, particularly with some of the Indian performers. And the photograph that Jordi has on the rear cover of his book is two small boys with one of the Indian performers taken in that tent at the Wild West show. Annie Oakley is one of two people who were part of the company that were with William F. Cody in Barcelona, who wrote an account of what happened in Barcelona. It's a short account, and in the course of the next few minutes, I'm actually going to read it to you in its entirety. Oh, how boring. I'm sure you're sitting there thinking, but I'll try and not make it too boring by presenting you with some images to go along with what she has to say. And there's a couple of things that she says that I'll stop and comment on. So, Annie Oakley begins her account like this. Then we had a stop at Barcelona, Spain. We arrived in a small tub that they called a boat. This was the town from which Columbus set sail for the New World. With the exception of one street and the Columbus Monument, the town had little to boast about. Beggars, soldiers, sailors and priests were most in evidence. I want to pause and say a little about the town from which Columbus set sail. I don't know if any of you on this side of the Atlantic grew up with the rhyme, in 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue with horses and men from the Queen of Spain, whose name was Isabella. I don't know if any of you are aware that in Spanish there is a refrain that relates to the voyage of Columbus, por Castilla y por León, Nuevo Mundo, halló Colón. For Castile and for León, Columbus discovered a new world. In 1888, the year before Buffalo Bill's Wild West came to Barcelona, Barcelona housed a Universal exhibition. And one of the key monuments that came out of that Universal exhibition was Barcelona's own Columbus Monument that stands overlooking the harbour. It's a very interesting monument that I don't have time to say too much about today, but I'm hoping that when the book comes out sometime next year, you'll all have the chance to read the book, and I have said quite a lot more about the iconography of the Columbus Monument in the book. The one thing that I did wish to highlight here this afternoon by way of context for looking at Annie Oakley's account of the time that they spent in Barcelona is that, of course, Spanish people had been dealing with American Indian people for an awful lot longer than the Euro-Americans that whose story was being presented in Buffalo Bill's Wild West. Spanish people had first encountered American Indian people on the 12th of October 1492, during that first voyage that Columbus made to this side of the Atlantic. And the way in which the relationship between European people, Spaniards, and American Indian people was commonly depicted in Spain and Latin America, focuses on the idea of Spanish law and Catholic religion as being the two major civilizing factors for American Indian people. And one of the statues that stands at the base of the Columbus Monument in Barcelona shows this Catalan theologian, Boyle, with the image of a kneeling Indian kissing the crucifix at his feet. And I think that's quite a useful image for encapsulating the sort of idea that Spanish people had about the dominant strand of the relationship between Europeans and American Indian people in the lead up to Buffalo Bill's Wild West coming to Spain. Annie Oakley continues, "The first day, the company took in more than $300 in counterfeit money. During our stay there, a merchant was arrested for making counterfeit money, but was released when he proved that his money contained more silver than the government money." Well, Annie, I'm afraid I have to disagree with you on this one. It's interesting when someone who has been a witness to an event, when someone who has been there, writes an account of the event a long time later. The event that the account that Annie Oakley wrote of this event, she wrote probably in 1925, maybe even in 1926, the year of her death. It was part of her autobiography, which was incomplete at the time of her death. And she's looking back over 30 years to the events of Barcelona. And I think it's fair to say that she remembers some things that didn't happen or that didn't quite happen. $300 in counterfeit money. When we convert dollars into pesetas and we look at the amount that would have been likely to be taken from the 7,000 to 10,000 people that attended the first performance, $300 is probably more than the entire takings. There was some counterfeiting going on in Barcelona at the time. I dare say that the Wild West may have taken some counterfeit money, but it wasn't $300 worth. There's an interesting sidelight to that story that appeared in the newspaper El Diluvio on the 28th of December, 1889. 28th of December in the Catholic calendar is the Feast of the Holy Innocents. It's the feast that commemorates the events described in chapter 2 of Matthew's Gospel, when Herod the Great kills all these young boys in an attempt to kill the baby Jesus. In Spain and in some parts of Latin America, the Feast of the Holy Innocents, punning on the fact that inocente in Spanish, inocen in Catalan, has got two meanings, which it has to an extent in English. It means innocent in the sense that we normally use it, but it also means gullible, someone who's easily duped or easily taken in. And in Spain and in some Latin American countries, the Feast of the Holy Innocents is the cultural equivalent of April Fool's Day. And just as in the Anglophone world, we play pranks on the gullible on April Fool's Day, so there are pranks played on the gullible on the Feast of the Holy Innocents in Spain and Latin America. And a prank that was played by the newspaper El Diluvio on the 28th of December 1889 was that all of this counterfeit money had been taken, that the people who had been doing it had been playing a prank on the Indians who were staffing the ticket box, the ticket office at the Wild West, and that from now on the Wild West would have their ticket box staffed by more appropriate people. Well, of course, It was never the Indian performers who were staffing the Wild West ticket boxes. And a couple of days later, the same newspaper actually admitted that this had been a prank. So there's something going on at the time. There was some counterfeiting. There is a story in the press as part of a joke that all of this counterfeit money had been taken by the Wild West. So again, there's an element of truth that we can perhaps understand 35 years later in Annie Oakley's story. But in the way in which she tells it, it certainly never happened. She then goes on. The city was stricken with Spanish flu. We had flu, smallpox and typhoid in camp. We lost our orator, Frank Richmond, who always presented me to royalty and gave tone to the company. One half of our people were down, but we lost only two more. They were Indians who died of smallpox. Mr. B, is the way in which she refers to her husband, Frank Butler, on a number of occasions in her autobiography. Mr. B came in one night with all the symptoms of the disease. He had just left Frank Richmond. He'd just been in bed an hour when Johnny Baker tapped on the door with the death tidings. Johnny Baker, as a number of you will know, was William F. Cody's informally adopted son, who was one of only four people, including Cody himself, who was involved in the Wild West from the very beginning to the very end. Johnny Baker tapped on the door with the death tidings. Although Mr. B should have been in bed, he looked after all the arrangements for poor Frank, made arrangements to return his body to America and all that. Then he took to his bed. He recovered. And then the fight was on between me and the disease. But though they put me to bed, and I worked for an hour weekly, trying to get into my costume so that I could take my place in the arena that afternoon, then I collapsed and had the flu in earnest. Now, what does that tell us? It tells us that even though Annie Oakley herself was ill, she wasn't so unwell that she couldn't appear in the arena. And she did. There is no evidence to say that she ever missed a single performance in Barcelona. It tells us that it was Johnny Baker who discovered that Frank Richmond was dead. It tells us that it was Frank Butler, Annie Oakley's husband, who made arrangements for Frank Richmond's funeral. Because unquestionably, even though I'm going to be challenging a number of the things that are commonly said about Barcelona in my book, and even though I'm challenging a number of the things that Annie Oakley said about Barcelona this afternoon, there is no question that Frank Richmond, the orator with the show, died in Barcelona on the night of the 4th into the 5th of January of 1890. When he died, he was taken to the what they called the New Cemetery in Barcelona. That's the New Cemetery as it appears now. He was taken to this mausoleum in the New Cemetery. And in the mausoleum that you see before you, his body was embalmed for return to the United States. One of the reports in the American press from a few weeks later says that the cost of the embalming and the return of his body to the United States was $300. Now, I don't have any way of substantiating that. It would have been a huge amount of money in those days, but it doesn't seem an improbable amount. As I say, it was only reported in one newspaper of the time. Annie Oakley tells us that two of the Indians died of smallpox. Well, if you read all of the accounts that are written about the Wild West in Barcelona, and for my sins, which must be many, I have read them all. Some of them say two Indians died, some three, some seven, one says 10. There's one that says seven Indians and three other members of the crew and Frank Richmond. You get a death toll, including Indians, crew, Frank Richmond, that runs from a minimum of 3 to a maximum of 11. Sorry, to a maximum of 14. Having looked at all of the records, there is no evidence that anyone other than Frank Richmond died in Barcelona. There is a grain of truth in what Annie Oakley says, but it doesn't mean that any of the Indians died in Barcelona. When they left Marseille in December to come to Barcelona, they had left two Indians behind in hospital. Both of the Indians that were left behind in hospital in Marseille did, in fact, die. One of them died while Buffalo Bill's Wild West was in Barcelona, but none of them died in Barcelona. One of the Indians who was in Barcelona, their next stop after Barcelona was Naples. Next stop after Barcelona is Naples. One of the Indians died in Naples. It's possible that he took ill in Barcelona because he died quite soon after they reached Naples. The other grain of truth in what Annie Oakley says, she says two of the Indians died in Barcelona. No, but two of the Indians took so ill in Barcelona that they were left behind in hospital. But they both made full recoveries. They both travelled from Barcelona to Italy and rejoined the Wild West, and they both returned to the United States with the Wild West. 102 American Indians, mainly Lakota, left the United States for that European tour with Buffalo Bill's Wild West. A number of them did die. We can account for all of them without there being any deaths of Indians in Barcelona. Slight caveat here. Sometimes Indians who didn't leave America with Wild West shows joined up with Wild West shows in Europe. American Indian people also travelled. So it is possible that Indian people joined the show along the way, and that some may have died in Barcelona. There was a lot of illness going about Barcelona at the time. We cannot be absolutely certain that none of them died. All we can say is there's no conclusive evidence. The major reason we can't be certain is the Spanish Civil War of 1936 in 1939 destroyed a huge amount of records in Barcelona. The records are incomplete. Therefore, we can't say for certain that nobody died. What we can say for certain is if anyone died, the records are missing. It seems improbable that a large number of people could have died and the number of Indians returning to America with the Wild West have matched up with the records. But we cannot absolutely rule it out. If any Indian people did die, then that's where the remains will be. You can see the way in which burials were recorded on those plaques that are along that wall at the time that these deaths took place. I have done a huge amount of investigating in Barcelona, but I have not had time to go all along that wall and the other similar walls to see if there was anything recorded there that hasn't been destroyed. And I don't think I'll have time to do that before the book comes out, but maybe sometime I'll have a couple of weeks to wander around cemeteries in Barcelona. Maybe when I retire. Oh, the poverty in this city. Mr. B and Johnny went to the butcher shop for a Christmas turkey. The dealer asked them if they would like a wing, a leg, liver or gizzard. He could not believe that anyone would buy a whole turkey. 200 beggars followed them, and the turkey, and the butcher sent an armed guard along with them. It's a nice story, but that didn't happen, surely. It's the sort of anecdote that you can think of, exaggeration for humorous purposes. People in Barcelona bought whole turkeys at that time. Barcelona was unquestionably Spain's richest city at this time. The idea that you would need an armed guard to walk away from a butcher's with a turkey It's ridiculous, but I think she's intending to be humorous here. And the idea that 200 beggars would follow you along the road just because you had a turkey. Well, let's say that we can't regard that as being particularly credible either, but it's a nice story that lends colour to the story that she's telling. She goes on. One day, I heard an awful tumult just outside the kitchen gate. The guard told me it was the hungry fighting over the garbage. He placed two boxes on our side of the gate, and I stood on them to look over. Back from the rubble stood a woman with tear-stained face. "Oh, I came too late, and Carlos will starve," she was saying in Spanish. I caught her eye, and with a finger at my lip, motioned to her to be quiet and come around the corner. I asked the guard to let her in, and each day she came there to slip out again with a bounteous basket under her shawl. That's another nice story. It's a story with an element of pathos in it, that again is something that you can see as lending colour to the narrative. But there are a number of things in that story that I would find questionable. For example, how is the language barrier overcome? Also, as an aside, the chances are that the poor in Barcelona at that time, the destitute in Barcelona at that time, wouldn't have been speaking Spanish at all. Most of the poorest of the poor at that period in Barcelona's history would have come in from rural areas of Catalonia, speaking only Catalan into the city. So it's not just that there would have been a language barrier for Spanish, and there were some Spanish speakers among the Wild West Company. I don't think there were any Catalan speakers at all among the Wild West Company. So how was the language barrier overcome? How did she attract the woman's attention with, if she's up there looking over the wall and this woman is down there rummaging through the garbage? How did they make this arrangement for the daily trekking back and forth? And when people were so ill, including Annie's own account, how was that maintained? So it's an interesting story, adds colour to her narrative, has got a nice touch of pathos to it, but I don't find the details standing up to any sort of critical investigation. She concludes. Smallpox and typhoid were becoming so bad, there was danger of the Wild West being held in quarantine. So on January 20th, 1890, the company sailed for Naples on a wretched small steamer, which was so badly ballasted, the pilot at first refused to take her outside the harbour. There had been illness prevalent in Barcelona in December of 1889. There was no quarantine at any stage in the city. There was no threat of quarantine in the city at any stage, other than a meeting of the Regional Council, which took place on the 31st of December, 1889. And as a result of expert reports that were presented to that meeting, they concluded the illness was not particularly serious and there was no need for a quarantine. On the 1st of January, 1890, it started to rain heavily in Barcelona. There was torrential rain for nearly 4 days. And by the 4th, 5th of January, the newspapers are saying, thank heavens for all that rain. This disease, whatever it was being caused mainly by a lack of proper hygiene. And now that we've had a good dose of rain, the illness is all dying down. Certainly by the 20th of January, which was the scheduled date for the Wild West to leave Barcelona from the very beginning, by that time there is no significant illness in the city. There is no suggestion of quarantine in the city. And again, it's possible that many years later, Annie Oakley is partially remembering things, remembering some things and not others, and she's writing a story about her experience in Barcelona. It's unquestionably a negative story. She is remembering, at all those years of distance, a bad experience of Barcelona. And a bad experience of Barcelona is what you'll find in any of the literature about Buffalo Bill's Wild West in the city. Probably one of the greatest contributions to Cody studies is Louis Warren's Buffalo Bill's America. And what he says there is, if you like, the received wisdom about Barcelona. Poor gate receipts, epidemics, poor attendance, Frank Richmond dies, and so do at least four Indians. The tour is cut short, and they're off they go to Naples. Contrast that with the report in El Barcelonés the day after they arrived in Barcelona. So many people crowding the quay to see the Wild West arrive. Contrast that with the coverage in the Spanish press of the first performance of the Wild West. They talk about huge crowds, and they talk about how much people had enjoyed it. The Wild West clearly made a tremendous impact in Barcelona. Had it not done so, then why would William F. Cody's tooth have been sitting in a glass case over 80 years later? Most of the posters for Barcelona have been destroyed. There is one that we know to be still in existence. It's owned by a private collector in Barcelona, and it is the image that you see on the right-hand side of the screen there, obviously with the wording in Spanish. It's Cody surrounded by the heads of various generals that he had served with. In the magazine La Ilustración, there's a beautiful line drawing of Cody that appeared when they were in the city. It's clearly based on the poster illustration. To me, the tooth told me when I was a simple English instructor in Barcelona, this had an impact. To me now, looking at it years later, from a more academic perspective, this drawing tells me this had an impact. There are some beautiful line drawings that appear in the Catalan magazines of the Wild West in Barcelona. And they're all accompanied by stories that say how good it was. They are all emphasising things that were particularly enjoyed, like the attack on the Deadwood stage, like the bronc riding, like the performance of Buck Taylor, all of whom you see depicted in that particular engraving. And when we look at the American press that was contemporary to the Wild West's appearances in Barcelona, they speak of remarkable success. They speak of the Wild West doing great business. They're not very lengthy reports, but there's a simple reason for that. To send a telegram from Barcelona when the Wild West was there cost 1.5 pesetas per word. That was a huge amount of money. So we get very short reports. But all of the ones that are contemporary with the Wild West being in Barcelona, they're all positive. As far as penetration into the culture, which I'd see as another key indicator of the impact that it had, there are numerous examples. Think of the fact that the El Diluvio, the newspaper I referred to earlier, there are any number of things that they could have chosen to play a Holy Innocents prank on their readers about. But they were playing it about Buffalo Bill's Wild West in Barcelona. Two other newspapers did the same, used the Wild West as the joke that they would play on their readers on the 28th of December 1889. And the equestrian circus in Plaza de Catalunya in the centre of Barcelona actually came up with a complete parody of the show. And that ran from the 28th of December all the way through to the 19th of January. And if you read reports of that in the press, it was a huge success. And Redshot, one of the Indians, according to one of the reports, went to see it and absolutely loved it. Those of you that are familiar with the Wild West, as in the Wild West exhibition, will know that before the final parade, traditionally, the last tableau that was presented was the attack on the settler's cabin. The finale of the parody of the Wild West that was presented by the Equestrian Circus was the attack by the pioneers on the Indians. And according to the report of Red Shirt being there, he just found this absolutely hilarious. The cartoon that you have there is from Esquilla de la Toracha, a Catalan satirical magazine, and it's two young lads, and they are joking about the fact that there's a play on words. Buffalo Bill sounds very like a Catalan expression, meaning, which is bufali lul, which means poke him in the eye. So they are making a joke out of the fact that this Buffalo Bill they see in the poster, they're reading it as if it means poke him in the eye. The Indians made a tremendous impact in Barcelona. And again, in Esquilla de la Toracha, we have this, under the heading New Fashions, we have these Indian-inspired hairstyles being presented. As far as the penetration into the culture is concerned, the guy who was the mayor of Barcelona was called Rio Citalet, and he'd served as mayor of Barcelona for four complete terms. He had brought in a major urban development project, had seen huge improvements in the city's economy, had brought the Universal Exhibition to Barcelona, had built the Columbus Monument, and had lost his job in the local elections of the 1st of December 1889, just before Buffalo Bill's Wild West came to the city. And so one of the satirical magazines, called La Tramontana, has Rio Citalet, who's the figure on the right-hand side, wearing Indian feathers, and don't they look like the sort of feathers that the Indian was wearing in the statue of the Columbus Monument, rather than the sort of Indians, the sort of feathers we'd normally see in North American Indians? And Rio Citalet is riding on a donkey, and he's turning up at the Wild West camp in Carre Montané, and it's saying a new chief arrives at the Indian camp in Carre Montané and has an appropriate greeting. Published in La Vanguardia, which is the largest circulation Spanish language newspaper in Barcelona, singled her out for particular praise the day after the premiere and said, even though in Barcelona we see lots of talented sharpshooters, Miss Annie Oakley was applauded for the admirable skill of her performance. It was a pleasure to see that young girl, well, she looked like a young girl from afar, take up position 6 or 7 paces from her rifle, then break into a run at the same time as her target was being thrown into the air, pick up the rifle, fire and blow the target into 100 pieces. I could have chosen 100 quotations from various newspapers and magazines to say how much the people in Barcelona appreciated the performances of Annie Oakley. But of course, from her own narrative written 35 years later, we can see that the feeling was not mutual. I don't usually put lengthy quotes on PowerPoints. When I was being trained many years ago to use PowerPoint, I was told this is a visual aid and you should regard every word on a PowerPoint presentation as an admission of defeat. I surrender. While the Wild West was in Barcelona, in an American newspaper, this account appeared under the heading Notes from Spain. This is indeed a godforsaken country, composed equally of beggars and soldiers, the former being, however, by far the most numerous. I am told these gentry all pay government for a license to beg. The Spanish army is armed with the best Remington rifles, but I doubt if many know how to use them. I recently asked a Spanish non-commissioned officer if he had shot his rifle at 1,000 yards, and he replied he never had fired it at all, and by the blessing of God, he never would. There's no shooting club here, but there is an enclosed ground where a man furnishes live pigeons. He stands about 15 yards from the shooter, throws them in the air at 5 cents a shot, the shooter getting every pigeon killed. In the shooting galleries, live rabbits and pigeons are set up at about 20 yards. But on account of the inaccuracy of the rifles used, bunny or pigeon is seldom hit. I enclose a copy of five, which make one, of five small coins which make 1 cent, which are in circulation everywhere in Spain. Boy, was there a negative view of Spain going about in America at the time that was nothing to do with what was actually happening on the ground in Barcelona. Relationship between the United States and Spain had been deteriorating over the entire course of the 19th century. As soon as the Louisiana Purchase had taken place, there were border disputes. There was a treaty to resolve that. Then there were further disputes about Texas. There was a treaty to resolve that. If you read the history of the relationship between the United States and Spain throughout the 19th century, it is really downhill all the way. And in 1898, the cataclysmic Spanish-American War. And in 1898, William F. Cody identifies 100% with the US cause in Cuba and in the Philippines against the Spanish Empire. And we start to see stories emerging about the time that the Wild West spent in Barcelona that have no basis in fact whatsoever. Again, March 1898, Cody is there saying that once the Spanish bullfighters tried to kill him. Well, if they did, nobody mentioned it at the time. And he was certainly not in Barcelona or Spain at any time other than that single 5-week run of the Wild West from December of 1889 to January of 1890. But it worked both ways. The Chicago Daily News was reporting in April of 1898 that William F. Cody was looking to be commissioned in a cowboy regiment. There's another story of the time that he wanted to round up an army of 200 Indians and go to Cuba, and that that would soon finish off the Spaniards. In Spain, the Spanish-American War is a catastrophic event. Spain had in the 15th, 16th and into the 17th century had what it called its siglo de oro, its golden age, when it had an empire on which the sun literally never set. It was the Spanish-American War of 1898 that led to the end of that empire. If you study Spanish history from 1898 to 1936, when Spain descends into catastrophic civil war, the memory, the legacy of the defeat to the United States that marks the end of Spain as a world power is a fundamental contributing factor to the disintegration of Spain into a society at war with itself. And my reading of the events in Barcelona, my reading of the very negative characterisation of the events in Barcelona that we find in the account that Annie Oakley wrote about the time that they spent there, is that the negativity derives from the negative relationship between the two countries rather than from what happened on the ground at the time. The time that the Wild West spent in Barcelona was a qualified success. It wasn't a huge success like the Chicago World Fair. It wasn't a huge success like Glasgow 1904. But it was a qualified success. It was not the sort of disaster that it's commonly been portrayed as. So thank you very much, those of you that have survived the 45 minutes of my presentation. I do want to give some more formal thanks to the Buffalo Bill Historical Centre Fellowship Programme that have provided me with financial support over the course of this summer when I've been here. The staff of the papers of William F. Cody, without whom this would not have been possible. Similarly, the staff in the McCracken Research Library, And Buffalo Bill Museum, particularly Lynn from the Buffalo Bill Museum, who is here this afternoon. Obviously to Centre Excursionista de Catalunya for the right to use their photographs. To the Carnegie Trust for the Universities of Scotland for their financial support for my work. University of Strathclyde for ongoing support and understanding. And to three members of my own family, my nephew Brendan, my sister Martha and her husband David, who took the original photographs from Barcelona that formed part of the presentation. So to you all, thank you, and Gramoyagav. I'm happy to take any questions that you might have. I think I've probably got about 5 minutes left.